And welcome to Law Unplugged. In this episode, we have a very special guest with us. We have Sir Ankit Tripathi, who completed his graduation in law from the Institute of Law Nirma University in the year 2019 and is currently a practicing advocate at the Delhi High Court and the Supreme Court of India. Apart from that, Sir has also worked as an editor at the Oxford Competition Law and has judged several national and international moots. To name a few, the NLUJ Antitrust Law Moot, Frankfurt International Arbitration Moot, Stenson Environmental Law Moot, and a lot of them. So in this episode, Sir has taken time out of his very busy schedule to talk to us about how one should present himself or herself in a moot court, how to use LinkedIn to utilize it in a manner that adds to our career, how do we demystify the art of legal writing, that is, how does one get the knack of legal writing, and finally Sir has a lot of fun in the rapid fire round. So if you like this episode, make sure to like, share and subscribe, and if you have any suggestions, recommendations or any feedbacks for us, feel free to reach out to us. Now without further ado, let's jump right into our discussion.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Law Unplugged. With us today, we have Ankit Tripathi, sir. So I would like to share that many law students just dream of being a part of moot court competitions. But on here we have Ankit Tripathi, sir, who has not only did well in moots as a law student, but has also judged famous moots like the NLUJ Antitrust Law Moot, Philip C. Jessop Moot, Frankfurt Arbitration Moot, and many others. So, yeah, in this episode, we'll be having a chat about how to do well in moots, how to write research papers, and apart from that. So without wasting much time, let's just get right into it. So, sir, first of all, please let us go through your 5-year journey at Institute of Law, Nirma University.
Yeah. So, to begin with, I
will
say that my 5-year journey in the law school was pretty mix of the co-curricular and the extracurricular activities, right? So because eventually law was not the first choice, as with most of the law students. So it was not eventually my first choice as well. And coming from a first generation lawyer, of course, I was pretty very much confused as to what to do in the law school, because it was just like after my 12th, after a year of gap of, you know, preparing here and there, I just landed in the law school. And like, to be very honest, my reasons of going to a law school was also not because of law, but because of some other XYZ reasons, right? And it was not an academic reason, to be very honest. It was not an academic reason. But then eventually I landed up to a law school. But then sooner I realized that my 5 years, because I realized that everybody here is competing doing some or the other thing. And of course, I was very fortunate enough that I was part of the Gurma Law School, right? So we also, like many other non-NAUs, we didn't have a lot of good support in terms of resources, in terms of infrastructure and all the other exploited factors. But yes, we were really fortunate enough to have some good support from our seniors. So when I landed up in my first year, I saw the BCI MOOT was being organized by my college, if I'm not wrong. So that really, I participated in that, I volunteered in that. Then eventually it got me interested into the participation as well. So in the first year I participated in learners, moot court competition. Of course, in first year I got the opportunity to moot in the first year itself and to represent my university. I got it, I did well. So eventually I started liking the moot court competition. So I started participating. I did for 3 years. Then I started, eventually, as I said, that I didn't have any mentors, to guide me throughout the law school. So I realized that it is better that I do whatever I want to do and I keep learning from my own self. Because rather than, you know, if just thinking what could be wrong, what could be right, I could have not done anything. So I decided that I'll do whatever I want to do. I'll just probably commit a mistake and then learn from that mistake. So I kept on doing that, like till 3 or 4 years of the law, I would say, till 3rd year of my law school, I kept on committing. I kept on exploring. Like I didn't leave any of those things, like from moot court to debate to MUNs to literary fairs to writing papers. Like I tried my hands on everything. Because of course, I was not pretty sure what to do and how to do, right? I was not pretty sure. I focused on my internships as well, so that of course land up at certain very good place after 5 years of law school. It ended up well, then I started realizing, because the one thing which I used to do in my law school was, nowadays I see that people used to watch a lot of web series and, you know, movies and some of the other things. But eventually I did one thing in my law school was, like, I used to learn a lot of videos, of memorial lectures, if you know, of Nani Palkhivala, Sri Hemisarve, and all those big eminent Buddhist lawyers. And I started reading autobiographies and biographies of them. So eventually I started realizing that, you know, it's very important to be a reader, and then I started realizing that fact. So I started working on my leadership aspect as well, because I understood, whatever it is, my 5 year law school, because I know I can learn here only. Whatever I do after my 5 years, it would be unlearning. And apart from learning, it would be unlearning as well. So I kept on doing, I started exploring on my leadership ability as well. So I contested for my school leadership position wherever. Then I applied international leadership position for Network for International Law Students. Then I started mentoring students, I started helping out. And eventually in my 5th year, I became the president of the law school, the Student Bar Association. I worked on various aspects, voting, debating, and cultural co-culture. So eventually, this was also to ensure that I do not have much pressure in my mind, because law school having 9, 10 subjects, specialization, of course, in one domain. So it was something, because I tried my best to do what I can. So that if I end up after 5 years, I should not have any regrets of, you know, that I could not do this or I could not do that. So I tried my hand for almost everything. It was a very peaceful journey. I did it from everything, like from A to Z, I almost tried my hand for everything.
Right, Saya. I think that every law student should do in law school what you did, right? Because what I see is that many law students across all law schools, they try to make their CV. Make their CV to only get that law firm job they want. They construct their CV for securing that one job. Whereas it is actually important to recognize your area of interests and actually then, you know, try your best at whatever you can. Right. So, and so while reading about you, I also got to know that you were engaged in various leadership posts in your college. So how did those leadership posts help you where you actually entered the field of law?
See, to be very honest, if you see the law school curriculum, what is currently now, it is very different from the business courses and the other curriculums of other disciplines, right? And leadership was almost one thing which is very much ignored in the law school, right? And what you are doing currently, like coming up with your founder organization like Law of Unplugged, is also a kind of leadership activity, right? Any small or big thing, whichever you are doing, or your own initiative brings a leadership, right? So what I realized that, you know, every lawyer, it has to be a leader. Like, without a leader, it's not really possible. Lawyering is not really possible. And business executives, the business managers, if you see the MBA courses, the leadership curriculum is there in their own portrait, right? They have the leadership, how to become a leader, like how to behave as a leader. But we lawyers were never taught in our law school how to behave as a leader, right? How to be a leader. And eventually, when I interned in the law firm and all, I realized that, you know, if you are investing for you, you'll be realizing that there's a lot of things involved in the law when you come out in a profession like law firm politics. The lobbying in the courts regarding your senior designation, regarding your, you know, getting the names of the government panel, getting the names of the designation, or getting a good local commissioner appointment, or getting any other XYZ thing. More or less, it requires that you need to have some kind of leadership ability. So, and of course, if you are a leader, it's not that only you learn about by leadership. I do not mean that political leaders, like, you know, who are there in the state law school, the local universities we have in our own independent state. I do not mean that. By leadership, I actually mean that leadership, you know, you can at least be a role model for your juniors, for your batchmates, for your faculties who are really look up to you that, yes, they do something good. You can make other juniors learn from yourself, right? So I started the leadership activities in my law school from very small area. Like I volunteered in the events, and eventually when I learned a bit of it, then I started at having my hands on the different leadership. So I became the vice president of my school association, then I became the president of the school association. I worked in the Moot Court committee as well of my law school. Then there's an organization called Network for International Law Students, NILS. So that organization organizes the various MOOCs. Like if you see, if you know, they have a business law review, they organize this MOOC. This MOOC is organized, the arbitration MOOC. The Frankfurt arbitration MOOC is going around, is organized by NILS. So they used to organize MNLU arbitration MOOC, that they all keep on organizing. So I became the president of that, of Gujarat chapter. They have chapter wise, like every state chapter was there. So I became their state chapter of Gujarat president. So I ended up organizing events. I ended up knowing more and more people because of their leadership ability. I started learning as to how to perform in a different crisis situation, how to handle the crisis situation, because of course, you know, it's very important to handle the crisis management, because you don't know when you'll come across any of the crisis. And if you know that if you are in a law firm also used to have certain kind of events. They organize a certain conclave, some webinar these days or something, and they don't usually keep an outsider. The associates only are helping in organizing that. So of course, it really helped me in becoming a good lawyer, whatever I am, still in the phase of becoming one. But I really felt that whatever activities I learned through my leadership in my law school, it was really important. And I think had my law school chosen to ignore this, I would have not got this opportunity. But I think most of the law students today should, and law school as well, should focus on the leadership ability as well, because that is something which is very ignored right now. So all the lawyers, they tend to become a leader one or the other way. Without leader, you need to be leader in the industry, otherwise you can't survive. You know how many lawyers are entering every year? You know, 10,000, 15,000 lawyers every damn year, right? If you are not a leader, if you are not able to come out of those traffic, you can't really, you know, make yourself or mark yourself in the industry. So that's why I think it's pretty important to learn leadership.
Right, very well said, sir. I mean, I totally agree with you that the leadership qualities is often overlooked by many law students. But actually, in fact, they are very important. They help you build those hard skills and also those soft skills. And apart from that, you know, the practical skills, which are also very important when it comes to managing your own practice or be it a law firm or be it anything. And yeah, and actually, sir, yeah, very well said that, yeah, especially in litigation, that, yeah, if you have to make a mark for yourself, yeah, you need to show some qualities, right, which help you make yourself stand apart from the crowd, right? So in that rat race, yeah, it is very important to develop those skills to actually make yourself stand out. I mean, as they say in law, you know, every man is a man for himself.
Right. I have another question to follow up there, sir. The other day I was having this conversation with some senior of our university, and he pinpointed out that in Fali Nariman's autobiography, Before Memory Fades, he has mentioned that if you see good lawyers in a courtroom, then they ask which stallion do they belong to. Like he says that if there are good horses in a courtroom, then they ask which stallion do they belong to. So my question being that how important is it for a young budding lawyer to join some senior or some advocate on record or some senior practicing counsel? Or how feasible is it to start an independent practice right after your college, right after your university?
See, the question which you have asked, it was a one question, but it has various disciplines to it. Like starting the independent chamber just after your law school, that's the one set. Like working with a senior after your law school is another set. Like working with an advocate in the court is another subset. So I would answer one by one, right? So first of all, coming with the aspect of working, how feasible it is to work with a senior just after your law school and how important it is. I would say with my personal experience and what I have learned through my seniors, whatever I've seen in the fields, is that it really depends on your interest areas, right? And not everyone is able to achieve, or not everyone is able to successfully come on that area. Like, you know, like if I am from a middle class background, like if I come from a middle class family and I want to learn the intricacies of the litigation, right? And so I can't really, you know, afford that I can work with a senior and then earn a meager amount of money and then continue, because financial commitment is really important, because there's a difference between the time of Sri Nanpalkiwala and our time, right? Because we have everything we need to survive, right? Because cost of living from the other expedited things. So I feel that it's not that your interest area should not be aligned. First is that first and foremost reason important factor which should be identified for working with a senior is that what you need to learn. Because most of the law students are not really aware that when you join a senior advocate's chamber, you would not really get to try your hands on drafting. Because if you see, as per the Advocates Act, a senior advocate is not entitled to accept the brief directly from the client. Right, so that is one very big problem. So what the seniors do is, seniors can only accept the brief from the advocate on records. Right, all the other advocates who are entitled to practice in the Supreme Court as per the Supreme Court rules. So suppose if I join a senior advocate's chamber, so and he's a senior designated counsel, so he would be receiving the briefs from the advocate on records. That means the most of the work with respect to drafting would have already been done by the advocate on records chamber. What my job would be, like his job is to argue in the court, right? So my job would be to more or less to prepare a case note of the entire, read the entire file, prepare the case note, prepare some interesting arguments from the side of the senior counsel, whatever side we are representing. So, and look upon those intricacies. So while we eventually learn as with respect to framing of the argument while working with the senior, because of course the argument has to be from the senior, it has to be a discussion from the advocate on records and the senior at the client. But eventually, the senior does give the research work and more or less the drafting of the case note, list of dates, and case briefs, more or less, the SMPs, if you see, petitions. They end up preparing that. So I also did that when I was interning with the senior counsel, Mr. Gopal Shankar Narayanan. So eventually, we learned this. This is the most of this. Now, if you learn with an advocate on record, when you work with an advocate on record, you will end up working on the ground level. Because an advocate on record is a person who works on the ground level in the Supreme Court, right? He usually accepts the brief from the client. He usually, the filings of the case is done in his own name. So it is he who actually does the drafting work. And in the litigation, of course, especially if you want to be very successful litigation lawyer, you need to have a very good hand on drafting. So of course, you can't learn much of the drafting in the senior advocate chamber, but yes, most of the drafting can be learned at the advocate on record chamber, because that is the chamber where we actually do the drafting compared to senior advocate chamber. So this is the difference between working in the senior advocate and the advocate on record. And my reasons, if you see, I eventually ended up joining the litigation chamber of an arguing counsel, and arguing counsel / senior counsel, because more or less the job are same. Because he's not a designated senior. So the only reason I ended up with, because my office is a both kind of like, we do drafting as well, we accept the brief directly from the advocate and records as well. So, and we do filings in our own name as well, in the High Court and the Lower Division as well. So this was the reason of me joining neither a senior advocate nor an advocate and records. I thought to choose a very different path, where I can learn both. I can eventually learn the art of the arguments from the arguing counsel, which he is, so that I can be very fluent enough to learn how to frame the arguments, how the conferences are organized, you know, the conferences between the senior counsel and the client, the conferences between advocate on records and the client. So I used to learn those aspects as well. And at the same time, I can file the cases in the lower court and the high court as well. Because most of the advocate on record, what they end up doing is they only end up practicing in the Supreme Court. And they don't get their hands on it, and this is not with all the advocate on record, but more or less. So I wanted to have the experience of the ground reality from the lower court, the tribunals, as I said, CCI, NCLT, NCLAT to Supreme Court. So that's why I got a very different chamber, so that I can have hands on both. Now, coming to the third question, how feasible it is to start an independent chamber after the law school? Well, I would say that it really depends on you. like if because of course opening an independent chamber just after your grad, after your law school, after your graduation requires not only a good amount of financial commitment, but it also requires a good amount of legal knowledge as well. So of course, if you are a second or third generation lawyer, or if you're not a second or third generation lawyer, if you're a first generation lawyer, I mean, you have a very good amount of legal knowledge that you actually see that you can work with an independent chamber and you have a good infrastructure, resources and everything, then you can of course end up joining, exploring your own independent chamber just after your law school. I have seen a few seniors from NALSA and they're opening their independent office just after their law school. But if you ask my own understanding, that I usually feel that when we are pursuing lawyering, more or less we are not doing our own job, but we are putting the interest of the client at stake, right? Because initial years, it is not our interest, but it is the interest of the client. We are not representing ourselves, but we are representing the client. And in initial year of practice, it is always better to learn from some of the other things so that you don't end up, you know, doing something so that which can divest the interest of the client, which should not something destroy the client's interest, because that is of first interest. Even if you speak of Nani Palkhiwala, he also started working with Jamshedji Kanga, Puneet Raghi also worked with Nani Palkhiwala, then they started working. If you're only senior lawyer, they never, even Gopal Shankar Narayan, I worked with whom. He even started with Mr. K.K. Venugopal for 8 years, he worked with. And then he ended up joining his, after 8 years, he got his own practice. He's doing well now, because he was a senior lawyer. It all depends on your personal experience, your financial background, and your legal acumen.
Right. Was very insightful. To hear it from someone who has ground experiences is what we don't get to do on a daily basis. So, and also there are a lot of myths about starting your own chamber or interning with senior counsels, and people are often, you know, misguided by websites or some third party hearsay, hearsay advice. But this session, I guess a lot of people find it fruitful. Moving ahead, right over to you, Hemant, over to you.
Yeah, that's right. So like the question what I was asking is like you've been judging a lot of reputed moots, right? You've judged JSOC, you've judged Frankfurt, you've judged the antitrust of NUJS, and like you've trust almost most of the reputed moots what a law student generally aspire to participate or win, right? And you've even participated in a lot of, like, you've even participated in these moots and even been judging them. So if you have an experience of both being on the podium and as well as that sitting on the bench of these moods. So I would just ask you this question is like a specific general thing, is that what does a law student require to be, what do you require a law student to be when he's like standing on the podium in any of the, what do you say, moods? Like what does he lacking in? Like is he lacking in the command of the language, or the facts of the case, or the jurisdiction issue, anything? Like what do you generally see as if you're a judge in the moot court?
I think go with the question. So when you see the moot court competition, so it really differs from national to international, right? And when you see international moot court competition, what really matters in international moot court competition is more or less your advocacy and your the delivery of the arguments. Most of the students, what they do end up doing in the international moot court competition, be it the ICC, Frankfurt or Henri Dunant, whatever it is, like they spend a lot of time of their preparation in preparing the memorials, the memorandum, right? And what usually they do is they don't usually keep a lot of time for preparing for their advocacy, right? And because of that, they don't really end up doing really well when it comes to the oral rounds. Like, if you see, because when I judge the Stetson round, because eventually, you know, there are international moot court competition where there are marking for the memorial. And of course, see, memorial, of course, I am not saying that you should not prepare for a memorial. You should, of course, end up doing. But you should properly divide your time. It should not be like your memorial, like your oral advocacy should be totally ignored. It should not be. Especially when you know that you are competing in an international competition like Frankfurt, you know, Frankfurt, like if you see the competition like Frankfurt arbitration, or for say Aberdeen moot like FDI, these moot court competitions do not really have the numerator. They usually have the skeleton arguments and they don't have much the aspect of the memorial making. So what usually matters is like the way you present and the way you actually, you know, deliver your arguments to the end up, to the organizer, to the judges, to the arbitrator, right? This is what we actually require now. So what I feel is that most students fail, or I would say rather they lack in the advocacy. And if you see now, I can see the students, I don't know whether it was MNLE Nagpur or MNLE Mumbai, I can see people from MNLE Mumbai, people from Lloyd Law Colleges, people from Christ Law Colleges, who are not really at par with the national law schools and the Jindal and the Symbiosis. They are doing really good in the moot court competition, right? And so it's not really about your college's resources or your college's infrastructure, but it's about your own preparation, how you are motivating and competing yourself in that competition. It doesn't matter like if the other college is having a very big library and a student is still not able to compete or you know, justify his or her substantially there. So this is what I feel more or less should be happening. When it comes to the national competition, I would say that most of the students, what they like they do, they lack is that the application. Like, the application of law is the most important thing which is required, because especially because the application of law is more or less required because of the fact that most law students, like if in the competition law, like so it was required that whether there is a hub and spoke arrangement possible in this particular case, what they do is they start researching on the hub and spoke cartel in India. If they get a hub and spoke cartelization in the say cab aggregators case, Samir Agarwal, they will apply the same case here without even, regardless of the fact whether Samir Agarwal has the same application to the case of current factual scenario here. This is the problem. Same goes with the constitutional law. So constitutional law move more or less, they end up to the square of 14, 19, 21. So 14, 19, 21 cases would be more or less Mahatma Gandhi, Indira Gandhi, Keshavananda Bharati, same in the all moot court competition. You can't just replicate each and every law point to your own law case because of the own facts, right? So I feel that it is more or less the lack of application of the law of that case to the particular factual scenario is a basic problem. Second, one of the basic flaws of the national moot court, which eventually I also committed in my first second year, then eventually I learned that students do not tend to give more focus on the fact sheet, because they tend to ignore the fact sheet. This is very much you know, ignoring the same law school student, because what they do is that they read the problem once, twice, they feel like constitutional law the problem or IVC problem, it could be two pager, just read and start working. So this they should not do, because see, law is there with everybody. Like, you also know the law, I also know the law, the judges also know the law. If there is one thing in which you can beat the participant and the judges, that is the fact sheet. If you try to have a command on your fact sheet, you can play with the facts. So the better you are aware with your own fact, you can play with that fact with your own judges. If you know the fact sheet, you can imply whatever law it is to your fact sheet. This is what the lawyers actually do in the court, like Mr. Mukul Rohtagi, like he usually do this. Fourth thing is, it would be very cumbersome, I would say, but students can do this practice, is that if you try to relate the fact sheet of your own particular moot court problem with the real life situation, this is the most practical thing which a student can do, which really differentiates between a normal student and a mooter, bringing the student, is this. If you can actually focus on this aspect of the competition, where you can actually work on this aspect, where you can try to relate the actual experience or the real life experience with your fact sheet, then you can practically make a difference. That is moral. Because of course, having 250 citations in a memorandum would not make you good. Even sometimes like having a good English would not make you a good mooter. It's not like this. I think many students who are very good fluent reader, who are a fluent speaker, end up failing in the competition. This should not happen. You need to have a very good research mind, you need to have a good team, you need to make sure that your team is very competent in with having all the different skills, from researching, from drafting to arguing. like very important aspect is choosing a team. For example, we choose a very dynamic team as far as possible, a very diverse team with respect to the skills required in the competition. So that is where you can do actually compete better in the national. And as I said, I divided national and international, it differs. So I would say advocacy is the most important thing, the way you present your argument in the courts.
Wonderful. Wonderful, sir. Like, I think law students like watching this will obviously will definitely get a point this time, like after this. They'll get this point of not only being good at memories, but also about being good at advocating. Yes.
Right. In fact, I have something to add to this. I think, sir, you would agree to this, that when in arbitration moves, the way you speak matters most. And when in comparison to constitutional law moves or say IBC law moves, there the fact is that the way you present yourselves in the Supreme Court of India is utterly different from how you present yourself in front of an arbitral tribunal. And I guess that was my biggest takeaway from the first move that I did. So yeah, I completely second with your point there, and I guess this was very enlightening for us.
The fact that I don't know if you would have followed Mr. Harjeet Salve, especially what usually happens, like most of the international moves, the jurisdiction is before the ICC, right? Stetson, Jessup, right? It happens, right? If you would have followed Mr. Harjeet Salve, how he was working in the Kulbhushan Jadhav case, right? When Mr. Harjeet Salve was presenting his argument and Mr. Qureshi from the Pakistan side was presenting his argument, there was no interruption from the judges at all. In the real life, there is no interruption at all. They presented an argument, they got 1.5 hours from this side, he got 45 minutes, he got 45 minutes. Both of them presented their argument to the judges. All the 9 judges who were sitting, they listened to their argument. They did not point out a single question. Why? Because in the international move, we really get to know, because we have what we want to read. Like, we can read, of course, whatever we want to read. But the important is how well you are delivering your advocacy to the judges. They usually get to know from it, right? From where you are doing. They won't usually interrupt you. That national move in the national competition, it happens more. There are more interruptions. Sometimes it happens that students get very frustrated and they end up answering in a very bad and rudely manner. It end up making their score very bad. International competition, it doesn't really happen. Like, they don't know at the ground level, they don't know much. So what they do is that they focus on the advocacy of the student. Because, you know, like, if you know, I think Amir went to the moot court competition. But see, even if I went to go to a moot court competition, is how much time the judges spent in working, working on the moot court proposition? Of course, 1/4 of the student, right? If I can, I would probably spend a half hour, like if it is of my interest area, I might spend more. But if it is not exactly a practice area and I am not spending much time, of course it is the student who will be doing better. So if you are aware of your fact sheet, if you are very confident with fact, you can try and mislead your judges as well. And it's not wrong to manipulate your judges until and unless you are doing it with something very unethical and very different manner. Right, because they usually read the problem when they come to the competition. Most of the judges, this is what actually do. They go to the competition, they read the problem, they end up judging. But a student is not doing the same thing. They get a lot of proper time. So you need to focus on that.
Right, sir. So, sir, I had a question that there had been many arguments that moot courts are actually very different from the real court practice. So, do you think this conception is true?
I would say definitely yes, indeed, because the way, as I said, I gave the example of Mr. Harjeet Salve, what usually happens in the moot court. So, in the international moot court competition, if we see Stetson, it is usually not the case. Like, you know, we usually ask the question, what is there, because more or less in the national round of the international competition, like the Jessup, Stetson have their national round. So, there we do ask the question. When you see the real scenario, in the ICJ, before the ICJ, this would not happen. More or less, student would not be very well prepared. The judges would be very well prepared. They won't be asking much question. It would be very calm and composed hearing between the advocates and the judges. Very cool. When it comes to national court, national courts like Supreme Court, High Court, and the national competition, moot court competition, I would say situation really differs, because there we end up saying, like lordship, may I come to the lordship? The council seeks permission to approach before the lordship. The council seeks permission to approach before the dais. If you're aware of the facts, this, that, a lot of, you know, flowery language is used before you even begin your submission. This is not happening in the current court. If you go and tell to the lower court judges in the Teesh Hazari in Patiala, like, ladyship, can I argue before the court, or this is the fact, you say, just go out and just come with the facts, whatever, I don't need to listen to this shitty argument, just come to the ABC of this argument, just come to the argument, what is, that's it, I don't want to hear ladyship, lordship, nothing like this, whatever it is, just come here. You can't be very, very use very flowery language. You can't be very submissive in the court, like you are there in your own mood, so like, you know, you end up speaking really less, you be really less, you don't talk much, you behave very lucidly. That do not happen much in a real court scenario. Real court scenario, if I am speaking, the others are also speaking, the third person is also speaking, fourth is also speaking, judges are also speaking, you don't really know. So moot court, it really differs from what is there in the actual court scenario. But yes, participating in a moot court really helps you to become a good advocate, because it really helps you developing the good research skill and a good teamwork, a good analytical mind, by which you can interpret the law, you can get hands-on on the law before the other participants. If you have participated in a competition or moot, like Amiya has, so Amiya would be having a first-hand approach when the competition would be taught in the law school, much ahead than the other law students, right? This is usually happens. So this, and of course you can engage in that area, making that as your practice area eventually. So it differs, more or less, it really differs, the actual courtroom experience.
Actually, just to add something, you know, apart from me also, Rajas has also participated in the NLIU Tanka arbitration moot. Vyans has participated in the RML NLU media law moot, and Evan has also participated in the Leiden Siren air law moot. So, what you said is actually true. I mean, whenever we learn those subjects in the fourth year, yeah, it will give us an edge to understand those subjects.
So one more question I had was whether in high courts or supreme courts the practice of interfering while the senior counsel or say his assistant is pleading before the bench, is there a constant interfering? Like, are there constant questions being put forth by the judges?
So like I didn't get constant interference from whose side, from the judges' side or the other advocates?
No, judges. From the judges, like as you said, in the national moot courts, the judges often interfere. So, what's the scenario in the high courts and supreme courts?
Yeah, it does. So, it depends from the judges to judges, and it depends from proceeding to proceedings. Like, so if it is a matter of like interim state, where we are opening for interim injunction, so there judges usually end up asking more and more questions, because you know they need to dispose at least 20-30 cases in a day. They can't keep on listening to a lawyer. Then it also depends which stage of the hearing is that. And usually in the admission matters, which is in the initial stages, judges usually ask more questions, because this is about the admission of the case. If the case is admitted, then they can of course hear for them from a longer duration. Because if they admit every other case, then they need to be they need to have proper amount of time which can be channelized to hear all of them, which is not really possible. So they usually do not interfere in the final stage of hearing. So when in any matter before the Supreme Court or the High Court, when the argument or the proceedings goes to the final arguments, right? There the interference of the judges you will find less, but more or less the judges do keep on asking questions some of the other time. What is this? Right? Many times the advocates bluff the judges. This case is applicable to this, so they ask like, how this case is applicable, like how can you say this? Not very, because in moot court we want to actually test the student. Here the judge is not sitting to test the lawyer, because he knows that the lawyer is well enough to argue in the court, right? But here the judges actually focuses on the interest of the client rather than the interest of the lawyer. In the moot court we focus on the interest of the students rather than the interest of the fact sheet. This is a major difference. There the interest of the client is at stake, and in the moot court the interest of the student is at stake.
Mm-hmm.
again, sir, just to add something, I mean, I would just say that in moot courts and an actual court, just one thing is similar, and that thing is whenever you put a good argument in front of a judge, then the confidence and the satisfaction which you get, that is immense. In both the cases.
Eventually, it happens, because most of the time it also happens that in many moot court competition I have been to, I have been told specifically that I don't need to show my emotions to the arguments, because it might eventually lead to the reflection of the result. This might happen. So especially in a very international moot court competition, I won't name, this usually happens where we are not entitled to express our emotions to any of the good arguments. But eventually, yes, I would agree. It happens in many moot court competitions. We usually end up being very happy with an argument and end up, that it might even end up changing the whole rounds just because of one brownie point and one good argument from one side.
Right. I guess that brings us to another question. Hemant, over to you.
Yeah, I had this question. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Right. This is the final, this will be the final question in this round, sir. I was just asking how is it feasible for a very for a young law graduate to develop a field of specialization in law, as soon as he passes out from his law school? How do you connect it?
If you ask me, preferably I would say that I missed out in my initial arguments, that when I was in my law school, I used to focus a lot on the constitutional law. I was a very avid constitutional law reader. I was a very avid constitutional law enthusiast. And the very reason of pursuing constitutional law was not because I wanted to specialize in constitutional law, because there is nothing specialization in the initial year. Because, my reason of focusing on the constitutional law was so that I can have a hands-on on all the laws. Because, see, constitutional law is a grand law. If I don't know the constitutional law, I cannot challenge the constitutional validity of the Competition Act, the IBC Act, or the taxation values, or the taxation wire. That is the major reason I focus on the constitutional law, because constitutional law has that base. And I wanted to make my base strong so that I can learn every other law during my practice. Because see, in the law school, you won't be taught IBC, you won't be taught tax, you won't be taught competition law to the full extent, right? This is the basic requirement. If you can study constitution, because constitution is the most ignored subject in the law school, right? So I decided I will not ignore the constitutional law. I study constitutional law as far as possible. I'll try to make sure that my interpretation of the constitution, whatever I am able to do, and I am able to use that interpretation in my interpretation in the court or the legal memorandum in my court practice. So whatever, no, because see, every other stay I need to use my constitution. Because without constitution, we cannot go any practice. We need the lower court, higher court. We need to use it, right? So specialization, I would not say that if I'm pursuing something in my law school, it should become my specialization. Even though if I'm into very much engineering, like AMIA is interested in competition law, it should not be like every student who is interested in competition should just, after the law school, focus on the competition law. I believe that if we want to be a full-fledged lawyer, like very good lawyer, good known lawyer, I would say that you should focus on the all areas of law, at least in the initial areas of practice, right? It can be banking, negotiable property, some civil law, some civil commercial court, arbitration. I'm not saying if there are 50 laws, you should focus on all the 50 laws, but I would say that basics like CPC, then arbitration, then property, then local high court, PIL rules, writ petitions, constitution. So I would say that you should focus on these basics, at least at the ground level, so that you can have a hands-on. And then after 2-3 years, because as I said, you don't know actually, because even if you ask me, I don't know, and there are a lot of young graduates like me who are into their practice of 1 year, 2 years, 3 years. You might know what lies after 20 years down the line, right? So it might happen that if I study or if I work in 2, 3, 5, 6, 7 areas, I can explore much. Right. So I am of the idea that as a young law graduate, one should not restrict itself to specialization. of course, it depends on the individual choices. If one wants to work in a firm, then of course I don't think you have more choice, because of course, like, if you want to work in a firm, you have to go in a competition vertical. You can't then work in the IBC also, then you can't work in the dispute also, you can't work in the taxation as well, right? So it usually depends. But for a litigator, I would say, for a person who wants to engage into litigation and want to have a courtroom practice, I would say that it's better to have a hands-on on the basics of law and then enter into the domain of specialization.
Yes, sir. Again, sir, just to add to this, again, yeah, I mean, what you said, yeah, I mean, I have a real life story. I mean, if you have heard about Rahul Rai, sir, I mean, Rahul Rai, sir, was a competition partner at AZBN Partners. So after becoming the partner at that firm, he left. He left that firm to join the chambers of Gopala Subramanian. Yeah, exactly. So, yeah, I mean, in one of his blogs, he stated that, I mean, there were many areas of law which were yet to be explored by him. I mean, there are many, I mean, yeah, exactly. So that is why he wanted to widen his horizon. So that is why he left his partnership to become a full-blown litigator.
If you know Mr. Somshekhar Sundaresan was a JSA equity partner. Like, he was a very good corporate lawyer, he was a very good security lawyer, very good competition lawyer. He used to do a lot of commercial advisory and competition advisory. He left the job of the partner in the law firm eventually to start his own individual practice. And I don't know if you have followed or not. Last week, his name has been recommended for the judgeship in the Bombay High Court.
Wow.
So you can see the level of change, like, you know, from working as a partner in the law firm, then exploring his own practice because he wanted to expand. Because in the law firm in JSA, he was restricted to commercial practice, like securities or competition, whatever it is. But as soon as he engaged into the individual practice, the solicitor in the Bombay practice, he explored more areas, and now he has been promoted to the judge, like his name has been recommended. So, you know, this is how it really changes, the way you transform. So it's not bad to start your career with a law firm, but eventually if you want to really expand your horizon and your knowledge, you can of course work as Mr. Rahul Rai did, Mr. Somashekharan Sundaresan did. A lot of people did like this.
Like, I mean, like, I would just add up this, like, the last question, even we have an audience here, we have even a constitutional enthusiast, Aziz is also a constitutional enthusiast here.
Who is a constitutional enthusiast? Oh, nice.
Yeah, good.
I really like those students who at least explore themselves or feel that yes, they have a zeal for the constitutional law, because more or less I see these days is like, not to any prejudice to all of you, they seem like I am interested in IBC, I am interested in tax, I am interested in competition, I am interested in the custom, like, but you won't find much of the student telling that I am interested in the constitutional law, because they know that the constitutional law means studying the Keshavananda Bharati, studying the Indira Gandhi and all those things. So they feel it's really very boring. But I'm really happy that I get to know that there are people who are really into constitutional law. Really good.
Yeah, I would give a quick follow-up and with a question too. To me, sir, what intrigues me much with constitution is the interpretation. So with every case that I read, like I remember once I asked you to give a review of my article on the
cryptocurrency.
Internet. Yeah. Internet and Mobile Association of India. So that case was, I think it's a 150 page judgment, and I didn't go through it like word by word, because there are a lot of figures and fact sheets mentioned in the case, so they consume a lot of pages. But what I loved about it was that the way they interpreted, the way they put forth the arguments. And a lot of times what happens is, even if you don't have a precedent to add to a case, it's more about the mentality of the judges. So it's what I have heard in a lot of interviews is that you run a background check on the judge who is sitting in front of you, and if he has been graduated from some from a university which is known to produce, you know, people who don't pursue capitalism that much, or who are more into favoring the upliftment of poor people, then you argue like that. So I guess that is what intrigues me much, that you always have something to follow to, even if there is no precedent.
Right, so yeah, and exactly, and just to add one more thing, I mean, one more thing about constitutional law, which, you know, I observe is that, you know, you get to be creative, right? I mean, yeah, exactly, right? You get to be creative. You get to express your opinion, you know, multiple point of views. And exactly, you know, that is what I like about competition law as well, because, you know, in the Competition Act, there is only Section 3, Section 4 and Section 5 and 6. So, I mean, but in those sections, you know, you can go very deep. I mean, there are many, many ways you can argue those sections.
Yeah, one last thing.
Yes, yes, I just pointed out, competition law is like, you know, it's not only about competition law, because competition law is one such law, but it's more or less related with many of the laws. So, like, if you would have followed the recent Monsanto judgment, like, you know, the interplay of the IPR and the competition law jurisdiction, the jurisdictional issue between the patent and the competition law, and in which that case is still pending. So, if you see that aspect, when you relate competition law with the corporate law, like mergers and the acquisitions, right? Section 5 and 6 and the specific M&A provisions in the company law, right? So, this is the beauty of the competition law, that just like constitutional law, and I would say that this is more or less with many of the laws, like whatever law it is, it can be correlated with the other laws as well. Like, the constitution can be related to most of the law because of its being of its nature of grand law. It is competition law is safe. Be it competition in IPR, competition in arbitration, the arbitrability of the competition law dispute, the most disputed area of domain as of now, what is the arbitrability of the competition law dispute. Then arbitration patent, arbitration and artificial intelligence. So it's, you know, it's really in the progressive stage, right? So I would say more or less all the laws are, you know, correlated. That is why I always say that you can't really be a pick and choosy kind of thing in a domain law, choosing law at least.
And so obviously I would just like to add one short thing. I mean, see, in every case there is the small guy filing the case versus the big guy, right? So that is what happens in any constitution as well as a competition law dispute as well. So I mean, the beauty of the bench is also that, you know, sometimes they favor the big guys, sometimes they favor the small guys as well. So, you know, both the constitutional and competition law aim at
same
protecting the interest of the small guys, small players.
Absolutely.
Right. I would because, you know, we are taking a lot of your time, so I would quickly come to another question. Is that you are also a contributing author at Oxford Competition Law, and though you told me that it is about to end, like your tenure is about to end, but you'd still like to hear from you as to what exactly is it, how one can reach the place that you have already reached, and how different is it from contributing to peer reviewed journal.
It's not a very big deal, and my tenure, I'm not very sure it will be going to be over, because it was for a period of 1 year, I guess. From I became in the last August, so I think August is reaching July, that's why I said it might be over. And of course, contributing author is not an honorary post, it's an honorary post, right? It's a paid job. So here, what we do is, like, we prepare case notes, short summaries, the case extracts of all the cases of the competition law from different jurisdictions. Like, some of them have taken France, some have taken Europe, some have taken Sweden, some of them have taken India. So eventually, like, suppose if Rajas is there, Amiya is there, Divyansh and Hemant, you all four, if they are contributing authors, you can choose one nation, and you can then focus, like, suppose there is a judgment recently of a competition law dispute of any particular country. You'll have to work on the competition law, you have to prepare small case note, you have to prepare a summary, you have to prepare the law extract. This is what we end up doing, more or less. And it was not a very big deal, it's an invited position. Last year they invited it, the application were invited, and so they were made the positions. And it's not only competition, this is going to be over, I told people exploring. So I'm exploring on arbitration, like there's a contributing author I am working on, there's Jas Mundi. So this is for international search engines, that is there. Mr. Yon is the head. So I'm working on that aspect also. There also I'm a contributing author. So it's not a very big deal, I would say.
Right.
There was this question of demystifying legal writing. So do you have, should we also catch that up?
I think the only thing which I wanted to focus was, you know, that these days if you see, I reviewed the paper of many students I came across. I would say that, you know, because recently it has been told in the circuit, legal circuit, that legal writing is of utmost importance, so people should really focus on the legal writing, legal blogs and everything. But you know what has actually happened in this quest is that people have actually forgotten the real importance of what is legal writing. So by legal writing, we did not actually meant that you end up writing everywhere and anywhere and anything. And it's not like if I am a legal writer, I need to write on every topic. It's not like that. I can choose the area of my choice and then I keep on writing on that. I can keep exploring and then work on that. Right? And I have seen there are people to prejudices, but I've seen various paid publications, very paid blogs, paid platforms as well, you know. So if you have publications on paid platform, paid publication and those two things, they don't usually end up helping you, right? You know, it might give you, because you know what has actually happened, that these days what is happening that whenever people open their LinkedIn, so they are like happy to share this. So most of the students usually feel that I don't have anything to share, what should I do? Especially in this lockdown period. So when most of the people were writing, they were writing that, oh my God, my friend is sharing this, my friend is sharing that, what should I do? I will be left alone in this. I need not to be missed out on this. So in the FOMO of this writing, legal writing and getting recognition, they end up writing and getting the publication anywhere. And you know, and also one thing which they lack in this life, in the quest of working, they don't focus much on the research part. So they're like, suppose if I got a topic, particular topic, X, Y, Z, if there are 5-6 different papers already on that topic, so what I do is compile the extract of various articles on those and then rewrite in my own paragraph. Right? So this might give you a short-sighted recognition on LinkedIn and amongst your friend circle, your peer circles, but it might not help you in the larger interest, right? This is a major difference which I see. I would really request the law student not to fall in this trap and not to follow this particular system. So this is very different than legal writing should be treated as an art rather than, you know, a compulsion. It should not be a compulsion, it should be an art. It's not like if you have 10 publications, 15 publications, so you will end up getting job in JSA or Shardul or whatever it is. It's not like that. So it's for your own interpretation, because by legal writing you end up developing your own interpretation. So if you read about topic, if I read about a topic like NRC particular, if I read about a topic like pre-tax insolvency, so I'll read it, I'll understand it, and to express my understanding and my language, I'll write it so that I can express it in my own language. So this is the idea. So most of the students are forgetting this. So this is the problem. Much on this.
So like adding to it, sir, you just say you read the statute or the law in it and then you write upon it, right? So what I get that, like, actually.
Yeah,
yeah.
Right. I guess we have covered almost each and every topic, and it's time for some questions, rapid fire questions now. So we have our brother Divyansh Agrawal here. He'll take over. Over to you, Divyansh.
Okay, sir. Okay, right. So moving on to our next segment, which we call On Your Fingertips, and it is similar to rapid fire round. Okay, yeah. Sir. So to begin with, my first question is, which is your favorite law to practice? Is it constitutional law, human rights, competition law, or arbitration?
Constitutional law.
Great. So my second question is, name any two things which are in your bucket list.
Two things in my bucket list. One is to write a law book, a book on law. Second is to engage in a live discussion with Mr. Harish Salve.
That's that's great. That's great. Okay, sir. My third question
To add on that, I mean, if you take out your own venture of writing a book, we would be more than happy to actually be helping you as contributing author.
Yeah, I'll definitely remember. I'm very happy that I have at least some of the helping hand. When I think of writing a book, I'll be knowing four people. So people are there who can at least help me with this.
Yes, sir. Sir,
we will give more than 100%.
Okay, so moving on to next question. Describe yourself in 3 words.
Patient, or I would say impatient. Not patient, I would say impatient. Impatient, assertive, and constant learner.
Okay. So, sir, in future, if you ever got a chance to make any silly law, then what would that law be?
Silly law would be probably a fine on people speaking, people using wrong English or wrong grammatical, like committing grammatical mistakes.
Just to add on that, I mean, those people who on WhatsApp, you know, instead of typing YOU, they say you, or they say, or you know, that kind of, you know, slang language, you know, those people should be
fine. I really feel bad. I even on WhatsApp, if you see, I really like, I'm not in the habit of working double, like the YOY or not using WHY, because you know, like because nowadays what has actually happened, this is the current age, and of course now after this pandemic crisis, in WhatsApp we are working very professionally. So if I type and talk in a slang manner with my friend, I might use that same language with professionals as well on the same WhatsApp platform. So I get a very OCD kind of thing when I see people committing this kind of mistake.
Yes, sir. Okay, sir, moving on to our last question. So what are the qualities which senior advocates look for in their junior?
Senior advocates, they look for, as I said, assertiveness. So most of the lawyers, you would feel that they say that you need to be very aggressive. It's not like this. You need to be assertive. So you can be... you can have your own opinion, but you need to respect the other opinions as well. So like most of the seniors, when they discuss with their juniors, they want them not to agree with them with everything, but they want to disagree with a respectful opinion towards them. I would say assertiveness. Second, I would say compassion, which is a most important prerequisite for working with a senior. And second is, I would say that, you know, compassion, I would say, of course, hardworking, because most seniors expect their junior to be as hardworking as they were, at least in their time.
Yeah. I think we've done with the segment, right, Divyansh?
Yes.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
to conclude, please. Sir, so talking to you was wonderful. Like, I think we got a lot of insight about law, like actually the ground reality, what happens. Like, you've generally told us the difference between the moot court path and the normal litigation, and I think, you know, we got the raw, what I say, you this eye-opener wala thing, what we did not imagine, like we were actually living in a different world of understanding this happens here, this happens here, but you said no, this doesn't happen here, you have a different world to come out, and again, and you end up with doing hard work, passion towards law, and the most important thing what I felt is the message you gave us is to explore things, like explore the interest of law rather than just running in a herd. Running behind the law firm jobs or something like that, explore yourself. I think this was one of the most interesting and informative sessions we had. Thank you, sir. Thank you for joining us, and hope we see you again as soon as possible. Yeah.